are thrilled to have you join us today to hear Daniel Jenkins talk with me about growing up in Kentucky and Yellow Springs, spending time as a high school freshman living with my father, a special treat for anyone who's done it, participation in drama during these years, and his entrance into the world of professional theater, film, TV, and work in various genres and venues. In other words, he's going to talk about how this interesting life of performance and creativity and hard work came about. I should say I've known Daniel and his family since he was a kid, and he's still Danny to me, which may slip out as we talk. As the emails you've received made clear, Daniel's work in theater and performance spans several decades and includes not only time acting, but also time at the Eugene O'Neill Playwright Center, the Sundance Playwrights Lab, the Williamstown Theater Festival, and as an apprentice with Jim Jory at the Actors Theater of Louisville. As you'll see, his work encompasses a range of genres, blah, 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 blah. Enough from me. Well, hi.
Hi.
And we're looking forward to hearing some stories about your storied career.
That kind of sums it up, really. But
can you talk a little louder?
Yeah, sure.
Okay. So should we start with your origin stories or maybe with your work with Robert Altman?
I was in Louisville. I was an apprentice in Louisville, you know, the theater my dad worked at for 15 years. I apprenticed there after high school. After looking at colleges, I didn't find anything that I fell in love with. I loved school, but I was just like, so at the end of my apprentice year, was it the end of my apprentice year? Gosh, timelines, you know, around then, Patrick Tovat knew Scotty Bushnell. Does anybody know Scotty?
Oh, yeah. Yeah. Okay. She did costumes, right?
I did costumes with my mom back in the
80s. Yes. Yes. And with our friend, Jemmy Faust.
And Scotty was right. Yeah. And Scotty was kind of like, well, she still did costumes with Bob, but she, Altman, but she also kind of was de facto casting director or whatever, you know, worked with casting with him. They were looking for young people. Patrick suggested me. I was in Kentucky. I flew to New York. I danced with Cynthia Nixon while I said words that began with the letter A. And I'm telling you, that was my entire audition. A lead in a film. So, I mean, it was the strangest thing ever. And so it was about, and I've worked with a couple people like this where they're just kind of more interested in the person than they are in the acting, as it were. You know, if you can make a sentence, and especially when you're young, you know, you just have to be able to be confident enough to say lines in front of people and they capture it. You know, but it was a little terrifying, like, you know, kind of improvising an audition, never having done anything like that. But yeah, Bob was a remarkable person in my life. He became like one of the other father figures, along with Paul and Patrick and my dad and so many people at Actors Theater. Bob was a real kindness in my life, a real mentor, a real advocate, and I worked with him. I got to work with him a few times, and was always an adventure.
Was that O.C. and Stiggs?
O.C. and Stiggs was the movie, yeah. So based on a national series of articles, he kind of wanted to. I think he kind of wanted to send up like the Porky's era. You know, he called it his adult exploitation movie, as opposed to, I don't think. A very successful outing, but there were amazing people in it. I had an amazing time. I'm not sure that I ever had a day off. I was in front of the camera every day for, I'm going to say 6 weeks, something like that, maybe 2 months.
Were you OC or Stiggs?
Yeah.
You were OC?
Yeah. And we were in Scottsdale, Arizona, right across from the dog track, because Bob was a big gambler.
There were really?
Games. I mean, there was gambling like everywhere you turned. There was a big, essentially a party every night that we would watch dailies. You would shoot the shot, and then at night, kind of unusual, they would watch the dailies. Back then it was actual film, right? So they had to make sure that it turned out okay. So they would watch dailies for technical reasons, but it was just like a big old, stoner food, whatever party every night. And people were just like, yeah, this is amazing. And I'm like, you guys are very stoned. I'm not really. But man, what an experience, and a great family too. This family is just fantastic.
Did you think all films would be like that?
No, I kind of knew all films weren't like that.
What else with Altman did you do? I know you did Tanner 88, which is, I think, the first thing I saw you in.
Oh, really? Yeah. That was really fun. And I thought that was interesting. That was maybe more successful material-wise, because there was a real script. My opinion is that when Bob had a really great script, I enjoyed those movies more. There were a number of his movies where a lot of it is just improvised. He just creates an environment, and people kind of improvise within that environment. And that is a particular kind of movie. I loved the ones that were based on a more solid script, and Gary Trudeau wrote the script for Tanner 88, the Doonesbury guy, really, really, really smart, really political, savvy, fun guy. And he was around a lot. So often on films, the writer is not welcome on the scene, because they're going to be changing some stuff. But Gary was right there for a lot of it, changing as we went. We traveled around and we followed the presidential campaign that year, and we would basically kind of hijack candidates and, sometimes ambush them. Sometimes we would arrange, for them to be on the show. And then Michael and I actually were on the floor of the convention that year.
Oh, really?
Press passes, and people, they were either really loving it that we were there because they knew what we were doing, or they were really like pissed off because there's like, we didn't earn our spot there, We didn't actually belong on the convention floor. We were fictional people, which was accurate.
So it was this other media people that were irritated?
Delegates. Who had, campaigned and worked and earned their spot, but I did get to hear Jesse Jackson speak that year, and that was unforgettable. Yeah.
I know you, Bob Dole was one of the people that you moved into the show.
Yeah, and, no, it's all really fun.
Then you also did a TV thing with him, the court martial, Kane Mutiny court martial.
Mutiny in Port Townsend on the West Coast near Seattle. My memories of that are like waking up. You wake up very early for film, often, like 4:35. And although that's just my normal. Hello.
Really?
Yeah. Yeah.
Did you get that from my father?
Yeah, maybe. I always remember Paul saying he would also nap in the most boring part of the day. Yeah, Port Townsend, we'd wake up really early. We'd get in the van, and it was up a hill, and you could see two mountain ranges and the sun coming up. It was gloriously beautiful. And I think the piece turned out pretty well. I realized that's the first time I wrote music for something that appeared on film. And I'm doing a lot of music writing these days. And
did your family sing together?
Absolutely. Yeah. I grew up mostly on a farm in Kentucky, but in Louisville too, but around the kitchen table playing music. And my folks were big roots music people. They loved Carter Family, and Jim and Jesse, and Osborne Brothers, all this kind of very early American roots music. I guess you call it country, but it wasn't Nashville country. You know, it was, traditional.
I think Ken, when he was at Antioch, I think he arranged to have a bluegrass band.
Boxes of reel-to-reel tapes of the folks that came through Antioch, and they were storied members of that community. And mom, dad, maybe Patrick, or no, I think someone else, maybe, but I know mom and dad would do like an opening act. So they would open for the Osborne Brothers and coming through. And yeah, so that was a big part of my growing up. I was really blessed with musical parents who pretty much every night after dinner, we would get around the kitchen table and play music.
So how'd you get to Huck Finn?
Well, ironically, not by way of Otra Banda, but but I did.
Yeah, we should mention Otra Banda first, because they went on.
I was 16, and Susan is us as well. On the 10th anniversary of their going down the Mississippi River on an 11 by 19 raft. Am I making those dimensions up, Susan? Is that close?
It's close. They were 11 by 18.
Okay, yeah. So a really small raft with a lot of hippies on it. And myself. So, yeah, that was when I was 16. And then when I was 20, I auditioned for a Big River here in New York. I auditioned for it when it went out west. It was in Cambridge and then La Jolla and then New York. And when it went to La Jolla, I auditioned for it along with another piece. So I had to do both roles and I didn't get it. So I was like, oh, okay. You know, that's life. It couldn't be more perfect for that, but okay. And then back to New York, I got another audition. And kind of all the pressure was off because I felt like, well, they didn't want me to do it the first time, but you know, I'll just go have a good time. And I did. I had a really good time. And John Short played Tom Sawyer. John Short was in love with me at Actors Theater. Mm. John Goodman was in that. I read with him. I basically was there all day reading every human auditioning for that show. So I felt like, well, I guess they want me to, you know, see how I work with other people. And it also ended up being the first thing I ever did professionally with my dad.
Was he in the original cast, or did he join later?
Later, he came after as the Duke, and then Brent Spiner, and then my dad.
So tell us about Roger Miller.
He was a really cool dude. I mean, he was a hard-living, sweet-singing, hard-working guy. And I end up being kind of really proud of what he accomplished because, you know, he grew up with his own biases and with his own kind of, I was really proud of him because what he did was he wrote gospel tunes. He wrote novelty. He wrote ballads. He wrote up. He kind of embraced the kind of the needs of musical theater, but also made it incredibly personal to him. And you know, in a new musical, what happens is that things get cut, right? And things come and go, right? And so I remember a heartbreaking moment where there was a beautiful singer, Michael Bryant, who opened the original, the beginning of Act Two, and his song got cut. And, you know, it's painful for everybody. You kind of understand structure-wise, sometimes that happens, but, oh, but I also remember like a magical moment of Roger bringing in this song called Worlds Apart. You know, I see the same stars through your eyes that you see through mine, but we're worlds apart, worlds apart.
Your brown eyes and my blue. Yeah. And Ron Richardson was Jim, right?
That's right. You said the lyrics correctly. I said them incorrectly. But yeah, it's gonna get a little emotional when I think about this, because when he brought that song in and sang it for everybody, it was devastating. It's just singing that song on the guitar. And somewhere, I think I have a cassette of Roger singing the score. But yeah, it was interesting, because as a person, he was who he was. He grew up the way he grew up. And then as a writer, he embraced all these perspectives, and I thought did a beautiful job. Beautiful job. I think it'd be a hard show to do now. I think it is a hard show. Not sure it needs to be done again, honestly. But at that time, it was certainly a big step for him.
I know the opening number is when all the townspeople and Tom Sawyer and the boys and the minister and the Miss Thatcher and whatnot, and they're all singing, "Hey, Huck, do you want to go to heaven? Yes. If you want to go to heaven, you better read your Bible. If you don't read your Bible, you won't know how." And pretty soon, more and more people join. And Huck has a few, you know, everyone was trying to tell me what to do. Yeah. Even Tom Sawyer put his oar in.
Right. You have a good memory. Yeah.
I really love it.
Yeah, that's a good tune. Really good tune. And even that, that's a hard thing to do, like an opening number in a musical. That's really hard to do. Set up the world, understand the world, understand you about the world. You know, it was good.
When I heard it, I felt I was going to be in good hands for the rest of the thing. Roger Miller is considered a country singer on country stations, and so they play a few of his songs. But he's so versatile and really interesting man. And you know, I'm glad to hear that he he's not an asshole.
You know, sweet, funny, great dude. Yeah.
So how about John Goodman? He played Pap, right?
He scared me because he's so imposing.
What?
So imposing, John. You know, he's a big guy, and I think I told you he's the same name as my
grandfather,
great. John Goodman, who I had a great relationship with. And I think I told him that, and I think he gave me a funny look and he wasn't impressed or something. And I was like, oh, this is going to be a tough mountain to climb with this guy. But I loved him and we got along famously. I did send him to the hospital once. That's my good John Goodman story. I think he tells this one too. So there's a moment in the show where Huck kind of escapes Pap, right? Pap is really drunk and abusive and, belligerent. And he takes, I can't remember if it was a frying pan or a stool. I think it started as a frying pan and then it turned to a big wooden stool. So I whack him, you know, I pick up the big wooden stool and I do one of these things where you hit the stool against the person's hand and he throws his head back, right? And looks like you hit him in the head. hit him in the chin and, you know, and then he falls down on this, you know, burlap cot. And then I talk a little bit more and then he staggers off and I roll up the cot and the scene changes. So I knock him out in the play. Well, either we did good eye contact or something happened, and the hand didn't really keep the stool from actually hitting him in the chin. And I got him and bent down, and I could tell something was a little off, but I continued speaking. And then at the moment he's supposed to get up and stagger off, he was a little bit slower up. And then I roll up the cot and I look down, there's a big pool of blood. I roll up the cot and there's like blood soaked through to the stage.
Oh my God.
John Goodman. And I think, Daniel, I think John is going to kill me. And he's supposed to come back as a skiff man. You know, he comes back, pulling people across the stage, and he wasn't on that boat. And I was like, oh no, I killed John. Of course, he was fine, but it was scary because I didn't leave stage. I didn't know what had happened.
Yeah. But
often got his stitches and came back. But scary.
Wow. So what did you do after Huck?
I looked for work, man. It's funny. That was a ridiculous, amazing, easy, that's the story of my professional life. Yeah, I've been blessed to work hard, but I've been blessed with being given work pretty much all my life.
Mm.
So, but that honestly, after that and before that, it wasn't not really much happening. You know, a lot of auditioning, a lot of looking for work, which is, what my dad says you get paid for when you get a job. All those times you were, looking for work, now you're getting paid. It was slow. I worked for Bob after that. I did Tanner 88. I did King Mutiny Court Martial then. I did a couple of like not very good movies. Young Playwrights Festival here in town, Playwrights Horizon. I started doing like off-Broadway stuff. I wrote a show with my dad actually, and we did it at the Vineyard, beautiful space downtown. I think we were the first show in that new space that they're still in.
What was the show?
It was called Feast Here Tonight, and he had written these monologues, beautiful monologues, Rupert's Birthday and Cemetery Man and some other stories, and I was doing a lot of songwriting then, so I wrote songs to kind of accompany them, and so they were songs and stories, and I don't know if it was terribly successful as a piece, but it was awfully enjoyable. Did it with us originally. We did it twice. And it was, getting to do anything with my dad was the gift.
Mm-hmm. So some of your TV work, like I think your resume said you were on all three versions of Law and Order at one time or another.
Kind of like a New York actor joke,
It is.
Yeah. Like my friend Cameron Mannheim, actually, who was a regular on this most recent incarnation of Law and Order. We did Young Playwrights together, and we all did as a joke, we put down which Law and Orders we were in. And then at the end of her bio, because at that point she had just started her career, she said, "And Cameron has never appeared on any of the Law and Orders."
No. Almost everyone has.
Well, I don't know about almost everyone, but yeah, I mean, it's the kind of thing, if you stick around long enough, they're going to want some old white guy at some point, or they're just going to want somebody else. They've been at it a long time, and I would say the film and TV industry in New York has actually grown a lot since then.
Mm.
A lot more work that actually happens in New York now. Like I did a couple of Netflix shows during the pandemic out in Brooklyn at a very new studio that Netflix up there. The Brooklyn Navy Yards is this huge, very much like what you would imagine a Los Angeles studio lot to look like, these big, huge warehouses that house studios like my brother Joshua works in Los Angeles.
Is he a best boy?
Right. Well, he was for many years, and people are delighted by that. But
yeah. And what is a best boy? What does a best boy do?
Best boy basically is in charge of how the lighting instruments are distributed. Right. So if you want a certain instrument, you have to go to the best boy, and he will look it up. He will find it for you. He'll give it to you, and he'll put it on his log. Right. So he doesn't do as much of the cable pulling, the physical labor, but he can. The best boys can certainly do that as well. And Joshua really likes all that. He likes the hands-on work. He was best boy for years. He was a lot best boy at Radford, which means any show that came in, Joshua was going to be working on. He would always, kind of have a running gig. And he kind of rose through those ranks and became managerial and then realized, I don't want to be in charge of people so much. after a while, it can be, that can be a burden. But he's close to retiring. He's getting his hours in, and he's going to move out here probably to Connecticut and be on this side of the world where me and dad are. And Matthew's down in Nashville, my older brother. But he's painting a lot, following in my mother's footsteps. There's a painting of my mom's right there. That's Joshua on a bicycle. Joshua Lone Ranger Jenkins, I believe is the name of it. That's the farm. I wish I could zoom in, but where is it? Right behind my head. There's the farm. There's another, that's one that's the one that's next to Joshua is a 3x4 variations on a still life. And then that is, next to that is a poster of our town that my mother silk screened in the basement because she made all the posters for Actors Theater, I don't want to say for 2 years. So the promotional material was made in our basement. So not only did Dad, write and act and direct at Actors Theater, but Mom actually made posters.
So it was a Jenkins family enterprise for a while. Let's talk about your parents, who many of us have deeply fond memories of. Joan was living with my father when he died. And so she's the one who called me. And afterwards she said, I didn't know what to do. I had to call this woman, I hardly know her, and tell her that her beloved father was dead. But it was, she was living in the house, and a lot of the students who, Roger Babb and, a lot of the Otrabanda people came over and hung out. And Roger actually discovered that a bookcase in my father's study pulled out, and behind it was his collection of erotica, including several pairs of beautifully made boots by a Mexican bootmaker. So you can't get a better surprise than that. Now, Joan and Carrie, my husband, would bring me items from the bookcase, and I would say, I'm sure it was riding equipment. I didn't want to know. I didn't want to know. But it was great to have her around, and she would cook. I mean, she's so wonderful. And she died in 2001, I think. And you and Peter Ekstrom were at her memorial service and spent time getting stoned in a maze of bales of hay or something.
The memorial service, that's a wonderful story too. So mom was living with her partner Betty at the time in Cape Cod. Peter came up, and I think he was indeed stoned a good part of the time, but it didn't matter. Peter's just fabulous no matter what. I don't remember being stoned, but I guess it's possible. Betty had a children's book about a Wampanoag clam bake, about how the Wampanoag Nation did a clam bake. And that's the Native Americans that lived on Cape Cod for the most part. A children's book, mind you, right? With pictures, and here's what they did next, and da da da. That's what we did for like 200 people. We did a Wampanoag clam bake, where you dig an enormous hole, you fill that hole with enormous rocks, you dump a cord of wood into that hole, you light it on fire, the rocks heat up, and then you get rock weed, which is a special seaweed that has little bubbles of salt water in it. And we had to go find that rock weed. Oddly, it wasn't on that beach where it was supposed to be. Matthew and I are driving all over Cape Cod looking for rock weed and putting it in bags in the car. You cover that entire thing with rock weed, so it's now steaming hot, salty amazingness. And everyone donated food. So we had spent the day doing these little bags that had sausage, potato, and onion in them. That was traditional, and you wrap them in cheesecloth. So we had a whole bunch of those. We had clams, we had lobsters, and we had corn, which was soaked in a giant tubs of salt water, which I have. That's the best corn I've ever had in my life, without a doubt. Maybe it was the circumstance, but wow, that was good. All of it went on there. And then we threw a tarp over top of it.
Oh my God.
And then, yes, there was a circle. There was kind of a pagan spiral that people made and decorated in the sand. And she taught Montessori school. So the kind of innocence and sweetness of that all kind of permeated the entire thing. You know, we did lots of wonderful, sweet, inclusive things. And just like crossed our fingers that this thing would work out, that and then we could feed 200 people. And we peeled back that tarp, and it was all ridiculously perfect. And I'm telling you, I'm such a, well, not a snob, but I love cooking, and I love, I got that from my mom and from Paul and their cookbook. It was spectacular, I remember at the end, people just kind of sitting over the edge of that hole, finished like it was a Roman feast. It was really fabulous.
Oh, wow. I never heard that. And wow.
Joshua made a boat, a pontoon boat out of like paintbrushes and canvas and stuff from mom's studio. A little sailboat that was going to put ashes on and send out to sea. And we were like, first of all, Joshua has never made anything like that. Second of all, how do you know it's going to go out to sea? just like get washed up. I'm telling you, he put that little gangly boat in the water and off it went. And we disappeared on the horizon. It was, it was a very, very special send-off, way too early from my sweet mom.
But yeah. Wow. How long do you soak that corn for in salt water?
Question, a pretty long time. We did it as soon as we had it. It's just a big old barrel, filled it with water, dunked it in there, and then we did everything else. Mm. And left it in the husks and threw it on. Oh, my gosh. That it could have just been a corn. As much as the clams and the oysters, everything else was great. That corn was ridiculous.
Wow.
Get me started on food.
Yeah. Well, we could go from
with Paul.
Yeah. Let's talk about your time with him.
I always loved cooking. I think I made a pie when I was 10. It was like a cherry lattice pie. And my dad was like, really? A cherry lattice pie? It's like 10 o'clock. Go to bed. But I always loved it. My Aunt Gladys would send me recipes. Of course, mom was an amazing cook. Make anything from anything, one of those kind of cooks. We had Chinese food on a farm in Kentucky, you know, back when that wasn't a thing. But then getting to spend that semester with Paul, who, if you don't know, was a gourmet cook. I mean, this man had a deep knowledge of food and love for it, and collected knowledge and recipes, and was so, you know, just remarkable as a human, but, you know, so willing to share that. I remember he did, I think he did it yearly, if not more, for, I can't remember where it was, but it was like a really fancy dinner where we made like stuffed cannelloni and, you know, with brains and all sorts of wild stuff. And I was like, how is this? But, you know, on the farm, we ate bull's testicles. We ate the weird stuff. But this very elevated, I would say mostly French school, because back then that was elevated cooking. And Paul did all that. And so I was in that kitchen where that was happening, and it was blowing me away. And being able to be whatever, his sous chef or his helper in any way, I felt incredibly honored. You know, not just about the theater stuff, but about the cooking stuff. It's like, come on, this is amazing. And then I think I get to be in the cookbook because of the eclairs. The eclairs became the thing that I had to be in charge of. So when people came, I think you're right, Matthew did more of the booze. I think I did booze for like Mr. Ebert, who would come across, you know, the lawn, and whoever. I would do cocktail hour as well, but mostly I was into the food, and he put me in charge of the eclairs, and I had to have the batter topped off, the filling topped off, and the icing topped off. So whenever anyone wanted an eclair, boom. We put. And I also remember the lamb stew. Does anyone else remember this lamb stew? And I have tried many, 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 many times to replicate it. It's basically like the leftover lamb, you're chopping it up. There's some tomato base. I think that's where the mystery is for the most part, is in the tomato base. It's in, you know, like an oval casserole dish. I'm putting this out there because I want the actual recipe. It's not in the Treichler cookbook. Oval, a casserole dish, lamb, tomato base, cream, and then Parmesan cheese, and then the broiler. And I'm telling you, that's a really good breakfast. Because after, you know, lamb stew is coming and you're not waiting.
So talk about Kenny a bit.
Yeah, well, dad is 84 now.
Wow.
Living in New York City. He moved here because his longtime partner, Catherine, is here. And they were bicoastal for decades.
Oh, really? Oh.
LA, working on there, mostly TV. And then he would come back and visit and stay, but Catherine lived in a smallish one bedroom. Finally, a two bedroom apartment opened up in her building, upstairs, one flight. And she said, all right, let's do it. And dad got rid of his place out there, came over in COVID, loaded up with Joshua, loaded up a big old, you know, whatchamacallit, pod thing, you know, with all the stuff. And that came across, and he quarantined up in Riverdale in the Bronx and waited 2 weeks to actually go see Catherine and move in. And we're still moving. I'm moving more furniture on Monday.
You just got over COVID yourself, right? Or still have it?
It's hard to avoid. I'm super careful. So is my wife, but yeah, you know, it's a big city.
Oh, yeah, talk about your family, your own family.
Oh, if I must. So Catherine, I met at Sundance.
You met where? Where?
At Sundance. Literally met in the airport in Newark. I walked in the airport and I saw this woman with a like this sundress on and this big hat, and I was like, "You're going to Sundance." Back when, you know, there weren't that many people flying, I guess. Anyway, we fell in love there, and it's, you know, what a romantic place. And we were friends for a couple of years, but got together, and now we have two boys. We were married how many years now? 30 something. Jack's about to be 30, 32 years, yeah, together.
Wow, that's good.
30-year-old son. So maybe you guys, some of you have like 30-year-olds in your life who are children. That feels like a larger number than any of the numbers associated with my birthday. It's going to be 30. That's wild. And yeah, my boys are kind of science-y boys. So I have he's doing a postdoc in theoretical physics in Germany. And,
oh, wow.
I know, it's beautiful, lovely. And Jesse is my younger son, who's 26, and he's been working for a couple of years at a lab at Rockefeller, and now he's going to go up and pursue his PhD in biomed.
Oh,
Rochester.
Where? Sorry, where?
Rochester.
Oh, uh-huh. That's where I went to graduate school.
Yeah, that's what Jesse's been doing. He's been working on COVID and Ebola and whatever at this kind of famous AIDS lab at Rockefeller with this husband and wife team who are so he's had a good couple years of kind of hands-on and now he's gonna kind of get back into the academia and
that's,
you know,
terrific.
My wife for many years, but now she's a speech and language pathologist. She's been doing that for about 7 years now, so I am officially the dumbest one in the family.
And if you're the dumbest, they're really smart.
Oh, yeah, they had to do all that sciencey stuff.
So I'm thinking we should open it up to questions and comments now.
Yeah, I should say, Daniel, you probably heard it, but I did make a CD for Ken of the bluegrass group that my husband Ian and Ken and Joan, and I forget who the fourth person was in it, and so Ken has that someplace.
Oh wow! Well, I hope it's not lost in that damn pod that came across the country. So
ask him about it, because I went through a period of putting out and selling CDs of all my of Ian's recordings, and in the process of that, so musicians were sending me stuff, and somebody uncovered this tape. They didn't know what it was, but I recognized right away that it was Ian and Joan and Kenny.
Well, I'm gonna put my email in the chat, and if you don't mind, send me an email. I would love to get one of those. If those are still,
I don't have it. I sent it all to Kenny.
Oh, okay. Well, then it's up to him. I put my email in there anyway.
Okay.
That's awesome. Oh, yeah. I would love to hear them sing again. That would be
No, it's really lovely.
And Ian, yes, I remember. Yes. And I remember the fourth person now. Well, I'll work on that.
Was that Steve Richmond?
Yes.
Well, he certainly was part of that group. Yes.
Yes, Steve Richmond. You got it. Yeah. That's correct.
Yeah.
Yeah. And then here's a question. Talk about the interaction with your parents through a lot of any advice and things from Ken and Joan.
And Catherine.
Dad's advice was don't read your reviews and don't whistle in the dressing room. That was it.
Say it, smart, again.
No,
don't not do what in the dressing room?
Don't read your reviews and don't whistle in the dressing room.
Oh, okay, fine. Fine, I got it.
All right, Ken, you know, no whistling. Yeah, no, he's smart enough to know not to, to mess with it beyond that.
Before there was the bluegrass, I think there was a jug band that Ken and Joan played in, and they'd come to Bob's in my house. Like, we'd have big dinners together, and they'd come there and play in this wonderful jug band with them. It was great fun. I did the spoons.
This is a wonderful audience.
Oh, so
some of great. My favorite people in the world.
I remember when your parents got married.
Yeah.
Yeah, we were all in the foundry rehearsing something, and Joni came running in and she said, "We just got married." Yeah. They'd run off somewhere and gotten married. Yeah. And they were the first of us, of course. Nobody was married, and then nobody had kids. And there you were, all three running around in your diapers, you know. But I remember Joni coming in saying, "I just got married." Right. Happy as a clam.
Yeah.
Can anybody else hear? Can anybody else hear Joan's voice? I can conjure up her voice. Mm-hmm. I can't imitate it, but I can hear it. Anyway.
Kenny and I did, as I was saying before, I think we must have done 20 plays together. Because it wasn't only, I'm sorry that he's not here. You have to drag him to one of these things, Daniel. We were not only at the Foundry together, where we did so many plays. We were at the Amphitheater. We were at Trotwood. And we were at Long Wharf. So we were just, I think it must be about 20 plays in all that we did.
I think what would be great would be if you and the other people who've worked with Ken could email him and beg him to be on our December show. I'm not sure we ever actually contacted him about being on the show, because many other things we had contacted him about, and he seemed reluctant to get involved in alumni type stuff. But now that he's in New York and with Dan and, you know, settling in there, he might be more inclined. So I think you guys should do it.
He and I have emailed back and forth, so maybe I can urge him to join too.
I mean, this has sort of transcended just being an alumni thing into being just a lot of theater and old friends from Yellow Springs. Really,
a bull has a nose ring. There, you can lead a bull wherever he wants to go.
Right.
But Ken doesn't have one.
He does have a particular loathing for Zoom also. He's just like,
loathing. Yeah.
He's not alone in that. I know some people who are just like, can't fathom the Zoom of it. I'm so used to it. It's kind of normal to me, but
I think it's wonderful.
Yeah,
I mean, geez, how else can
bring him over to your house and do it with him or something? We'd have to see Kenny. He's just such a big part of all our lives.
I will send you, Daniel, I will send you a version of this when I get done editing it and fixing up the mistakes and cleaning it up and zooming in and et cetera, et cetera, and show it to the old man and see what he says.
Yeah.
The Entrebanda show was also really a fun show.
Oh, yeah.
And, you give them a couple of things to see. I mean, they're downloadable. It's not a big deal.
Yeah, I will. I will. I'll pass it on. I will say, don't get your hopes up.
How could he resist all of us begging him?
Just watch. we have a story here from Anita. I remember Ken in the late 60s at Antioch, when guys were doing different things to get out of the draft. He was dancing a lot and had a very hairy chest and shaved strategic parts of his body before he went to the Dayton draft board. He got out, but I never forgot that very functional ruse.
What possibly
he was
on his chest?
What? He just shaved different parts, patches wherever he felt like shaving, and showed it off before he went to Dayton. And I mean, there were a lot of guys who did a lot of things, but yeah, I never forgot your dad doing that. It was very cool, and it got him out.
Hey, I listen, I went in and I just treated it like another co-op job.
Well,
wow.
Yeah. And then I have a question. I think it's for Paula. Where did Paul get the cuts of meat, and special ingredients and so forth that you probably could not get at Luttrell's?
It was challenging. It was challenging. But we did buy some beef from Ken Jenkins. Mm-hmm. He was raising a strain of, or I guess a breed of beef called Charolais.
Simmental.
Well, Charolais is what I remember. And we
sure.
Paid. Yeah, okay. Okay.
Put it in the thing.
I can assure you that what replaced Luttrell's is now a much fancier, much more complete grocery store in Yellow Springs. It's not the old town anymore. The school.
Well, no, I mean, as we say in this new version of the cookbook, when we wrote that in 78, it was even hard to get fish in the Midwest. I mean, to get really good fish. But now, I mean, actually, we just got yesterday in the mail from a place called Gold Belly, which is like a garage sale, a worldwide garage sale for good food. And it's expensive. But what we got is a coconut bund cake that Tom Cruise sends to 200 of his friends once a year. And we got it. We had it at a party and we ordered it. And it's fantastic.
Dan, say more about the farm. What the farm part of the farm? What did they farm besides this special cattle?
Yeah, so the Simmental, the cows were something we eventually ended up with, and we were trying to, I believe, at that point, breed the horns off of that particular breed of cattle. So there's a polled gene. A polled means no horns, and a horned gene. And it's kind of like blue eyes and brown eyes, right? So you're trying to breed a bull that will take the horns off of any progeny. So
well, I remember visiting Joan on the farm. I think I was with Moses then, and she learning how to
inseminate
bulls. Yes.
Whoa. She said it went, she was, her arm went in all the way up. Yeah.
And she proudly displayed her artificial insemination license and certificate on every job that she went to, like the Playwright Center in Minneapolis. There it was on the door, the ballot.
Well, it's something to brag about.
Watch out, don't mess with this lady.
Door, that would make me happy. No, but we grew, you know, lots of crops, lots of animals, all the animals, goats, chickens, ducks. We didn't have sheep or pigs. I guess that's a whole, universe of its own. But lots of crops as well. Corn back then, tobacco, hay, so much. Yeah.
You think that's where your brothers got into the science?
Well, my sons got into the science, but
your son, right, okay.
I mean, we all just, I don't know. I look back on it now and it was an amazing way to grow up. It was just an incredible gift to have that much connection to the land, have that much access to my parents in a way, right? Mm-hmm. There wasn't anything else to do, right? So
where in Kentucky exactly? Out towards Berea or?
Between nowhere and bumfuck. It's way, way down there.
Oh, okay.
It's the southwestern Kentucky, about 40 miles southwest of Bowling Green. Nashville is actually the closest big town. Mm-hmm. lives now. Logan County is where it is. A beautiful, beautiful part of the state. But we were, we weren't anywhere near even the small town of Auburn. We were near, like 5 miles or so. But Patrick actually is who got us down there, because Patrick had a farm down there before we did. And then Mom and Catherine fell in love with the wild roses as they drove up the drive. And that was the end of that. Dad had no say in it.
What was the chronology of the farm in Antioch, in Yellow Springs?
For me, the chronology was we were in New Haven when I was very young. We were in Yellow Springs when I was in nursery school, and when Ellen knew me as an infant. I'm Ken. Then New Haven, where he met John Jory and Arvin Brown. And then Dad and John came down to Louisville to kind of revamp the theater down there and be co-artists. And then Dad ended up doing most of the acting, most of the directing. And he was there for about 15 years.
Oh, really?
And then 6 of those years for me, Dad was probably there. Anyway, 6 of those years for me were spent on the farm. So the last 6 years of that, early 70s, we moved to the farm. I came up to visit Paul in my freshman year of high school. Mom moved up to join Paul. And then I followed her up the following year as a sophomore in high school and went to Yellow Springs High after I had my time with Paul.
So that was in the 70s.
That was in the 70s. Yeah.
Yeah.
In 81 from high school.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. I just didn't realize. I didn't realize you were on the farm that long.
Yeah. Yeah. And I was in I left a little bit before the farm kind of went under, because small farms are impossible to make profitable. It's really, I don't know how people do it now.
They don't pay themselves. That's how they do it.
I don't know. But what a remarkable gift my childhood and life has been.
Yeah.
Lucky I still fella. Have recipes. I have recipes that I still do that your mom taught me. We roomed together on an Antioch co-op job in New York. Mm. And she taught me how to make spaghetti sauce and how to do a roast lamb. And actually, it was a recipe she had gotten from her mother. I remember her mother helping us with it too.
I want those recipes.
Yeah, me too. Me too. I do. I wish I'd had them for the cookbook.
Well, the secret with the secret with the lamb is putting mint on it or something exotic. I don't know. It's very good.
Stabbing little holes in the fat and shoving garlic in there. I remember doing that. The
garlic too. Yeah, of course. Garlic and everything. Yeah.
And Shannon, you asked about Styles and Theater. Do you have memories of taking Styles and Theater?
I do. You were there with me. I remember you being this little guy, but you were so sweet. And I had long red hair. We sat in the same room. There were probably only about 8 of us. And it was in some room, maybe in the library, where we would watch movies. So I kind of learned about expressionism and symbolism, and the movies were so wacky, they made no sense to me. It was like going into a foreign land in that class. But I loved him so much. He was just hilarious. And I think it was that he didn't usually teach there. This would have been, I don't know, I was there 74 to 78. So I'm not sure you were there, but we had that class together. And I was thinking, well, you're a high school kid. You're coming to college. We're wide-eyed and bushy-tailed, and we just, watched all of these strange movies and kind of just broke up our idea of what theater was. I mean, every boundary, every class, everything was just so unusual. And it really took the art history world and put it into our minds. You know, all those Brockett textbooks that you would study kind of got broken. It wasn't like it wasn't theoretical. It was just wildly story after story and crazy movies. I wish I knew what they were. I need to do it today, you know? Back then it was too crazy to me, but it was good. It was
interesting. I think I could recreate most of those.
Yeah.
Oedipus Rex was from Guthrie's theater, I think, a filmed version. And my father, it was interesting. He was very interested in the way audience members responded to different styles. And he worked with Lee Clark, who was the very famous scientist at Fells, for a while to try to set up a psychogalvanometer that would be attached to the audience, and you would get a readout then at the end of the show that showed how each person, you know, what the high points were and what was, you know, not anyway. So that went into his thinking about styles. And one story I remember is that there was a student who, when he showed Oedipus, which I think was the first film usually that he showed, and she couldn't stand it. She just couldn't stand it. She turned white and was shaking and had to leave.
Oh.
And but when he showed Andalusian Dog with, you know, the razor slicing the eye, she didn't turn a hair. No, it just so individual and so interesting. And that's part of what went into his idea that these styles are not historically predestined. I mean, that they're available all the time in one way or another, and they serve different purposes. And he uses, you know, after the Xenia had the first big tornado that kind of destroyed a lot of the town, he took me over to drive through and he said, if you want to see surrealism in real life, look at this, you know, where a broken Barbie doll would be hanging from a church, you know, just things like that. I guess that isn't too illogical, but Barbie in the church. but yeah, I found, I think a lot of people on this backstage have took that course. I might have told this story, but one woman took it and she just hated the 8 a.m. I mean, I hated it too, but I made it to class. She would always saunter in late with a cigarette and bare feet and put her feet up, you know, on that chair ahead, seat ahead. And then one day in the cafeteria, she said, Paula, tell me frankly, what do you think of your father's course? And I said, I'm learning a lot. She kind of huffed and went off. And then that same semester, she was the costume person for Tartuffe, which was one of the plays that I was in, playing Tartuffe's daughter. And she ordered the costumes, which were very elaborate, right? With velvet and lace and so forth. And mine was about four sizes too small. There was no way. I mean, it was like for a little girl. And so she said, well, I'll have to make one. So she made me a dress that was this baby blue satin, fake satin. And she did some ruffles on it. And I was so embarrassed. And Kirsten was in that show. She was a maid, I think. And the review in the Antioch Record said she was in a drab costume because it was brown. And she said, you know, every review this guy does, he hates me. And now he even hates my brown costume. But anyway, yeah, I think it was an amazing course. And he started to turn it into a book. And so I transcribed a bunch of his lectures. But he died before we could really turn it into what it should have been, with, you know, illustrations to show those different lines and the sets and all that. It would have been terrific.
I remember House of Bernarda Alba, who talked a lot about those kind of things.
Yeah.
In a stylized way, and it was very interesting.
I think, wasn't it Steve Hendrickson who was on and did the set for that, or set it for one production?
The old one.
Several productions he may have. Yeah.
And he said he was just starting, and he got the, what do you call it, like the slant of the of the stage, right?
The break of the stage was impossible. Bernarda Alba, and I was about 17 years old at the time, and I don't know how I got cast as Bernarda Alba, but I remember having a terrible time with the rake of that stage.
Right. I mean, it was almost life-threatening.
Yes, it was. Yeah.
Would he have made a syllabus for that class?
I think so. I could look. I just recently found his notebook from the classes he took at Yale for his MFA. I just came across those. I'd never seen them before. So I'll go back to the attic at some point.
And also, I have a picture of us in the dressing room together. So I remember she was in House of Bernarda Alba, your mom.
Well, are there other questions, or shall we? And Daniel, do you want to have the last word here?
God, no. Sick of one's own voice after a while. What a treat.
A treat, a great treat. And we'll all work on Kenny.
And thank you for that, clam bake.
Oh,
yeah.
Paula, look through the attic some more.
Yeah, I will. But you know that clam bake should be in the cookbook.
Get the kid's book. I'm telling you, that's all you need. The children's book. I'll look it up.
Oh, okay. Yes, do that. Yeah. Send us that. Thank you.